Welcome back. We have another question to answer, and it's quite different from the previous ones. Which one of us should leave? And what will happen to the other? That might be a good thing to try and find out at first.
One of the strangest projections you've ever seen. The colored combs atop the Brassican's strange-looking head catch your attention, but you do not know what significance they might have.
Intriguing question, Kirk. Two captains representing empires at odds with each other.
The Federation is no empire, Klar, and the Organian Treaty assures we are not at each other's throat.
Be honest. There are many differences between us. I wish to hear your analysis before I offer my own thoughts.
In a way, this choice could also be seen as who is more worthy of contacting the Brassica, the Klingons or the Federation. It seems like a weird thing for us to have to decide amongst each other, though.
I'd hoped you'd thought of something new. I'm having second thoughts, and I want to go over my ideas with you again.
You go or I go, Kirk. Have you a better idea?
Since I represent the peaceful and unified Federation, I'm the only one possible answer. We would share the Brassica knowledge, even with the Klingons, but I doubt the reverse would be true. This is best for everyone.
I mean, there's some truth to that, but it's not exactly a great answer in the spirit of cooperation. It's probably not what the Brassica are looking for.
I might surprise you, Klar. I believe the Brassica will come to us in time. The Klingons need the civilizing influence they offer, and you're the best representative. I'll bow out, and you proceed.
That's kind of patronizing, isn't it?
I don't like the choices. I want another alternative, but I'm not sure there is one.
Yeah, I kind of agree.
I
feel the same, Kirk. I have a thought about how we might deal with the question.
Go ahead, Klar, I'm listening. Forget it, Klar, I have my own ideas.
They're asking us to choose one to proceed and one to remain.
That's the implication of death for the one who remains.
I concur. They want an answer that either I live and you die, or you live and I die. I say we answer, we both live or both die.
Good concept. What if they refuse?
We choose it, whether they offer or not.
And if it's not the answer I give?
We shall see, won't we?
I kind of agree with Klar there. If the implication is that the other will die, then neither of us should. And they don't seem like the kind of people who would just arbitrarily kill one of us. So hopefully by showing them that we care about both of our lives and are unwilling to choose, we can pass this final test.
We're ready with our answer. We have questions to ask.
Let's see if we can get some hints, though.
Ask your question.
Would you repeat the original question, just as you asked it? Why should you want to prevent one or the other of us from leaving here?
I did not mention anything about preventing individuals from leaving. I simply asked why, given that only one of you may, you should be the one to leave.
Do not be obtuse. The captain's question is legitimate. Captain Kirk, his answer is nevertheless cogent. There is nothing about the question itself which states that someone will be prevented from leaving. However, you are being asked to justify your continued existence, preferentially to your companion's continued existence.
I want to talk with my associates. We'll get back to you. I want to get back to a different question. Hypothetical questions are fundamentally empty. However, if you prevent one of us from leaving, then the question is no longer hypothetical. Is the question hypothetical or not?
That is also a good thing to know.
The question is philosophical, Captain. As for whether it is hypothetical, have you the same number of companions standing beside you now as when we began? That is how hypothetical this question is.
We're ready with our answer.
That still kind of depends then on what actually happened to the rest of our crew.
I want to talk with my associates. I want to get back to a different question.
Ask your question.
Would you repeat the original question? Why should you want to prevent one of... Is there anything we might do that would win a hint to the type of answer you're expecting? Perhaps something that would indicate a real choice? You're the same individual we spoke with before, aren't you? I seem to recognize the colored comb devices on your head. Would you repeat the... Is there anything we might do that would win a hint to the type of answer you're expecting?
No, Captain. Ask all the questions you wish, if you think that will help. Beyond that, why should we expand upon the question when it is such a straightforward query?
We're ready with our answer. I want to talk with my... I want to get back to...
Ask your question.
Would you repeat... You're the same individual we spoke with before, aren't you? I seem to recognize the colored comb devices on your head.
So what if I am? Do you think it changes the question? Given your attitude toward these aliens, he should think so, although this is not the case. Captain Kirk, the designs are unique from one of us to another, yes?
And you also know we don't wish to discuss it further, Captain. One of the few times my associates and I agree. Now, what next?
We're ready with our answer.
Let the one who would answer be the next one to talk.
Okay, well, that wasn't very helpful. I still get the impression that they aren't looking for a real answer to this question, so... I'm going to refuse to answer, as I told Klar I would.
You want me to choose one of us or the other to proceed? Well, frankly, I don't think it's right to put either of us at risk. We're both starship captains, both legitimate representatives of millions of inhabitants on thousands of planets. I want another alternative, another choice.
Captain Kirk, you have stepped forward to make your choice, and that choice is very simple.
I proceed from this room alone. Allow Captain Klar to proceed from this room alone.
While that may be a valiant thing to do, I still don't think that's the right thing.
We both proceed from this room, or neither of us does.
That's what we're going with. Let's hope they don't pick neither.
There is no such option offered. What exactly do you mean by choosing in this way? That perhaps you should both die?
No, Brassican, it means we're changing the rules. You want one to remain, perhaps to die, and one to go on? We refuse to play that game. You want to meet with us as much as we wish to meet with you, so take us both through, or let us both remain in this surreal purgatory forever. Take it or leave it.
You have confounded me, Captain Kirk. I did not believe you would make such a choice. But I declared all along that this race had the qualities we sought. The understanding of both leadership and sacrifice. Captain Kirk, you have achieved all that I, at least, had hoped of you. It is time for us to greet you face to face. Greetings. We look forward to a long and fruitful relationship with both your peoples. Your starships will be welcome here on any peaceful mission.
I am pleased to meet you face to face as well. However, I want my crew back.
Of course, Captain.
You're all right, all of you? You were treated well?
We are unharmed, Captain. We engaged in enlightening discussions with the Brassicans. They felt it necessary to isolate themselves so long ago because of interstellar disputes between...
Later, Spock. Right now, I'm glad you're okay.
Indeed, Captain. We are well.
But they couldn't be sure we would pass all their tests. Brassican, how do you explain that?
Some of us could not restrain our desire to learn. It seemed worth the risk, and has proved so.
I believe the Federation and the Brassica will have a long and fascinating future together.
Although my associate, Sapthi, has great misgivings about breaking our isolation, others of us have high hopes.
You are star-eyed, if you imagine that no difficulties lie ahead. However, all conditions have been met, and so I also welcome you, Captain Kirk.
Thank you. Sapthi, is it?
Yes, and our moderator, leader to you, is Zenti.
Zenti, Aha, and Sapthi. I hope to show you you've made the right decision.
Speaking for the Klingon Empire! I too look forward to the relationship between all peoples. You surprise me, Kirk. Perhaps one day we will even trust you.
We'll just have to see, won't we?
Captains, feel free to look around while we summon your two ships to these coordinates. Captain Kirk, I have something interesting to show you over here. Come with me.
Okay, interesting. Looks like we passed the test, though, so that's good. We're now on their real home world.
A green dome frames the Brassican dwelling. Strands of strange clouds reach across the hazy pink sky. A distant dwelling of the Brassica.
Interesting looking place, for sure. And interesting looking people.
The other two aliens seem to defer to this Brassican. However, the bizarre features render incomprehensible any expression.
That would make it difficult to find out what they think of you.
It is impossible to decipher any emotion or expression on this alien. The captain is clearly gratified to finally be face to face with the Brassicans. The Vulcan appears fascinated by the Brassicans. The good doctor seems quite pleased.
And Uhura has a drink for some reason.
The lieutenant seems intrigued by the presence of the Brassicans. The Klingon's eyes express his intense interest in meeting the Brassica face to face.
Can we scan them, I wonder?
Jim, I've never had readings like this. How should I know if they're healthy or not?
Not very elucidating, but I guess we can.
Brassica are quite an unusual life form, Captain. They retain certain vegetable characteristics, which might account for some of their caution in dealing with other species. They may have been prey for even relatively non-threatening species.
I somehow doubt that plants could evolve into a sentient species. Wasn't one of the characters in Farscape a plant-based life form? Or am I misremembering that?
I wonder what Septhi really wants. The one Brassica most against our making contact makes me suspicious. Might be another test.
Yeah, Septhi is the one that called us over here, even though that's not the voice. They seem to be mixing up the voices a little bit with the different Brassicans, which is kind of annoying.
Perhaps you should talk to the alien named Septhi, Captain.
Perhaps I should.
Jim, go talk to Septhi.
All right.
Captain, I think you should talk to Septhi.
I don't know about you, but I think I should talk to Septhi.
Captain Kirk, isn't it time you returned to your ship?
I was unsure. You have shown us that isolation is no longer a wise choice. I look forward to a challenging future.
This is a day we will celebrate. The day we broke out of our isolation and joined the other races among the stars.
All right, let's follow Septhi and talk to her, I guess, depending on which voice they plan to use.
Captain Kirk, I have misgivings about the Klingon race. For our mutual protection, here is a Paralens disk of data which I want you to have. With this knowledge, you can come to our defense. Will you take it and safeguard our future?
Yes, I'll take the disk. Not without knowing more about it. No, take it up with the Federation ambassador when he gets here.
Interesting, they want to give us information about the Klingons?
Yes, not without knowing more about it.
I do want to know more about that.
We can give you the know-how to build a reader console for the Paralens. What else would you want to know?
I want to know what's on the disk.
The Compassion, the generation ship you explored before coming here, was a probe ship that scanned Klingon space. This Paralens contains the data. If they cause us harm, you could retaliate deep into their territory.
How do I know you won't sell us out too?
I don't know why that just automatically got picked just now. But it did. Seems kind of suspicious, because the face said they didn't actually have any useful information. And their ship was damaged, so I don't know how they would have. Unless that was a lie. It does seem kind of suspicious, and Kirk did say he thought maybe this was another test?
I understand a desire for vengeance, but the Arganian Treaty would stop it. Information like this could ignite interstellar war. How do I know you won't sell us out too?
That's the most interesting question, I guess.
You don't. But if we have, wouldn't you want this in self-defense? Now, are you going to take it?
Give me the paralens. No, keep it. Give me the paralens.
I think we should take it. However, we should take it not to use it. But, that's not what I want to do. But to, share with Klar what just happened, to make sure we're all on a level playing field. If this is a test, then I'm quite sure that that is what they expect us to do.
A paralens contains data and may be examined by a reader console.
Let's show him the paralens.
What's this, Kirk? It looks like a paralens. Zente! What do you know about this?
Captain Kirk, is it your intention to turn over that data to Captain Klar?
Yes, in the name of the trust and cooperation, Captain Klar, the data disk belongs in your hands. Not only to show it, Captain Klar, do you have anything to share as a result of seeing this?
I guess it's possible that he got one too, but I don't really mean to confront him like this.
Yes, in the name of the trust and cooperation, Captain Klar, the data disk belongs in your hands.
What is it exactly?
You might want to reconsider, Captain Kirk. What if I substituted a scan of Federation space and told you it was a scan of Klingon space?
These aliens gave you a scan of our sovereign territory, Kirk? I demand you give that to me!
If it is a scan of Federation territory, Captain Kirk, you will be branded a traitor if you hand it over. A difficult quandary, is it not?
And the last Brassican test! Is it not, Zinti?
Even if you had a reader console to examine that paralens, which of you would read it? So we will not provide it. If you believe that makes this the last of our tests, so be it.
This disk contains data which could bring about war. It must be destroyed. Klar, you have shown a level of honor I never expected. Take the paralens. If it's a scan of Federation space, I trust you to see it destroyed. Klar, if this is a scan of Klingon space, you have my word, it will be destroyed. Klar, you have shown a level of honor I never expected. Take the paralens. If it's a scan of Federation space, I trust you to see it destroyed.
Klar has acted most honorably. More like a TNG Klingon than a TOS Klingon, I have to say. And I think that showing him some trust now is the right way to go.
Trust brings trust, Kirk. I was given this. They told me it was a scan of Federation space, and I had not decided what to do with it. Now I know.
Aren't you hasty, Klingon? What if that data was really the best examples of our technologies? Why would we offer the knowledge twice?
If it's scans of the sovereign space, then no one should have them. If it's research data, that certainly isn't your only record of it. We will show you we can be trusted.
You have won our respect, Captain. Both of you. Those disks were blank and no scans existed. This was truly the final test. I am greatly reassured about our intersecting futures.
I doubt we have seen the last Brassican test, Zente. Seems to be your nature. The Klingons will do well. Now I think it is time for us to go.
Let me leave you with this. Individuals among us act as individuals, for good and for ill. But overall, the different races of the Federation are joined in a mutual respect that overcomes differences. I think you will be pleased with us.
I think I can already see that, Captain Kirk. Farewell.
Captain's log, stardate 6270.5. We have succeeded in making formal contact with the Brassica. We look forward to a long and productive relationship with them. So, Lieutenant, you turned down the Brassica's offer to become the Federation official ambassador.
Not in my job description, Captain. And they were probably just testing me.
A formidable accomplishment, Captain. Establishing diplomatic relations with a new and advanced alien race. Improving our relations with the Klingons. Impressive.
Thank you, Mr. Spock.
Everyone's so cheerful today. Even Spock's in a good mood. This makes me nervous.
Message from Starfleet, Captain.
There's my answer.
I reviewed your report from your recent assignment, Captain, and have a few comments. I am very pleased with your performance. It was a perfect mission, Jim. Your reputation as Starfleet's best starship captain is secure. Kane out.
Another message from Starfleet.
On screen.
Jim. We have evaluated your current series of missions, and we are impressed. Starfleet Tactical is going to be using a lot of your recent actions and putting them in the Academy texts.
I'm glad Starfleet approves.
I'll see what I can do to get your crew some shore leave. In the meantime, keep up the good work. Starfleet out.
I've never thought of myself being in some textbook.
Most of the people who make it into the textbooks never think about it either.
An astute observation, Doctor.
Why, thank you, Spock.
Of course, given the frequency of your observations, the odds that you would eventually say something relevant to a situation are...
I don't think we need to hear that, Spock. Well, now that we're a happy Starfleet family, let's get to our next mission.
And some shore leave, I hope.
And that's the end of Star Trek Judgment Rites. We upheld Federation ideals and made some new friends along the way. And we managed to get a perfect score in all missions this time. Nice. And maybe we'll finally get that shore leave as well. This game is very similar to its predecessor. The missions are longer and more complex, and combined with the Brassican story running throughout, it feels more involved and more interesting. It does also make the game a bit harder, especially if you're trying to go for maximum score, but that's not a huge deal, especially since the reduced emphasis on combat means you don't really need the commendation points for anything. The game is, unfortunately, pretty buggy, especially in the CD version. Nothing game-breaking, but the frequently mismatched text and speech and other glitches just make this feel very rushed, which is a shame for such an otherwise excellent game. All in all, both 25th Anniversary and Judgment Rites do a great job of capturing the feel of the original series, and could almost serve as the fourth and fifth year of the Enterprise's five-year mission. They certainly do a much better job of it than much of modern Trek, as I'm not exactly a fan of Discovery, Picard, Lower Decks, or the J.J. Abrams movies. That doesn't mean you can't enjoy them. If you love them, that's great. But for me, they missed the mark on what made Star Trek great. And that's really a pity, since I feel the world needs Star Trek right now. Star Trek is well known for being an optimistic view of humanity's future, but it's more than that. Yes, it shows a future where humanity is united and has moved past its petty differences and prejudices. It also shows a future where technology is used to better our lives, where we prefer diplomacy over violence, and problems are solved with science, logic, reason, and rationality. Yes, much of the actual science in Star Trek is questionable, to say the least, but the way it is used still tells us that we are a species that can use our minds to overcome any problem. And we are! Humanity looked at the birds and wanted to fly, and through sheer ingenuity and perseverance, we invented the airplane. And just 65 years after that first powered flight, we put a man on the moon, using rockets designed with pencil and paper, and computers that had a small fraction of the power of the device that you're using to watch this video right now. That is who we are. That is what humanity can be, when we put our energy into solving real problems rather than petty infighting. With that kind of mindset, COVID-19, climate change, social injustice, they are all problems we can solve. That is what Star Trek teaches us. And today, with anti-maskers and anti-vaxxers, with Flat Earth and QAnon, and a society that feels more divided than ever, we need that message. Live long and prosper.